The opinions expressed on this program are those of the host or guests and should not be interpreted as statement of fact. Independent fact-checking and corrections are encouraged.
Can we get a cup of coffee in here, please?
Wait, that was Nicolas Cage? Is that what you're telling me?
Damn good coffee. And hot.
Wake up, America. You've got a dog that needs walking. That's right, sunshine. Just put on a big pot of strong coffee and get ready to type your little hate mail with your opinions about kumbaya and flat earth insanity. Stand-up comedy? You want stand-up comedy? Well, we've got sit-down comedy. It's time for Coffee with a Dog. You make me laugh.
Don't bet on it. That's all I got to say. Goodbye. What are you looking at me for? Don't you have better things to do on a Tuesday morning? Better. So, yeah. Oh, good morning. It is Tuesday, December 5th, 2023. I hope you are having a wonderful day wherever you are. But Tuesday is the worst day of the week. I maintain that. I will never stop. What's going on over there? Yeah, you. Oh, excuse me, folks. That music sounds a little bit like Rush. Rush is considering getting back together. They're looking for a drum. And now they says they are looking to recruit one of the world's greatest drummers, but it doesn't say who it is. Rush fans might be a little upset about that because Neil Peart really was the captain of that ship. I say the captain of that ship, not shit. Although, not everybody loved Rush. But that music kind of is Rush inspired. I don't know why I did that Tom Sawyer inspired intro there, but there it is. Anyway, Rush is thinking about getting together. Some people, diehard Rush fans, I don't know, not gonna love that idea, and some will. Kiss had their final concert the other night, Madison Square Garden, and a lot of their diehard fans did not like it. Did not like it, I say. Did not like it, I say. They felt it was too corporate. Nothing special about it. It was just a home-dome, humdinger of a corporate show is what it was. My friend Kevin was there photographing this stuff. And, lots of lights and pyrotechnics and all of the spectacular costume BS that you get with a Kiss show. I'm never a fan of Kiss, I have to say. Never a fan of Kiss. But I have played a few Kiss songs over the years by with a gun at my head, actually. Not a fan of Kiss. Not a fan of their music. Not a fan of them personally, or what they did in making rock and roll pretty much like professional wrestling. Never been a wrestling fan either. Take it out on me. Get mad at me now. It's not like you weren't mad at me when you signed up for this thing. Anyway, so we have a good show for you today, but it's clean comedy. Both our guests today are clean comedians. And I don't really know how to talk to people who are clean. Because I'm dirty. I'm filthy dirty. I'm disgustingly dirty. I'm toxically dirty. And I don't know how to relate to people were clean. But we we're gonna try to make it as funny as possible without me being a disgusting, dirty, dogly. I can't say the fuck. I can't say fuck. I can't say shit. I can't say cunt. I can't say piss. I can't say. Maybe I could say piss. But what good is piss without a fucking shit? Anyway, Willie has been on the road. Rodian, he's back today, and he is responsible for our first guest coming on the show today. Let's say hello to Willie. Good morning, Willie.
Good morning.
Oh, you're working. Your sound is working well. That's a surprise. your recording system is in Grants, New Mexico, but you are not.
Yes, that's right. My sister's actually going to send it to me, though.
Send it? No.
What do you mean no?
It'll get lost. Wait till you get back home. It's going to get fucked up. You can't trust... Bad enough, we got to trust the people who sell it to get it to Grants. You don't want to... if it gets lost, I'm gonna find you, and I'm going to fucking cut your head off and piss in your dead skull.
Okay, all right.
Wait till you get home. Why does the big rush? I would like you to be there using it, but until you have your hands on it, there's no big rush to get to it.
Well, right, but my thing is like I'm going to be moving around so much that I kind of...
So take a bus trip down there and get it. Don't let it be shipped. All right. I'm tired of yelling at it. But I'm also pissed at you trolling me on YouTube. All right. And we'll say hello to GD. GD's there waiting very patiently to curse you out as well.
I'm not going to curse you out. Mine dog coffee.
Why don't you curse him out?
I don't always drink coffee, but when I do, I say, fuck Willie. What the hell is wrong with him?
There you go.
I mean, drink coffee, but when I do, it's a moving experience.
He's not here. You might as well do it when he's here is all I'm saying. I mean, that's all you do when he's not here.
Yeah, when I'm not here, he tries to get me replaced and stuff. What the hell?
That's
only
true.
The once, and that was because it was a nicer dick.
Hey, it only needs to be one time, Gigi.
That's true.
Like, I don't...
Willie was trolling me on YouTube. Like, I don't have enough problem with trolls. I got Willie trolling me on YouTube last night. He's like leaving like little snide, nasty comments.
What? I forgot what I said, but I don't even remember what it was about.
It was about the girl that was dancing at the club Friday night.
Oh yeah. But well, you said you want comments. After
I want comments.
Show,
I don't expect people on the team to be trolling, but there you go. It is what it is.
Come on, it was funny. It was funny.
You think so? Yeah. Clean comedy. I'm not. It's Tuesday morning. I can't be clean.
Then don't. Oh, let Willie be clean.
You'll be clean. I don't think so. I don't think so.
I thought you meant my urine.
Yeah, yeah. Now, who are you roadieing for? What are you? Is this like a big time outfit or just like some?
No. So the company I work with is Witch Hunt Productions, and they do various different stuff. Like what we did this time is I helped with the Aladdin production that was at the Washington Pavilion, which was actually really amazing. It was actually the biggest production that the Washington Pavilion has done to date. It was so, and the crew that we had putting it up and taking it down, because I also was there when the trucks came in and helped set it up. And I got to tell you, some insider information about the magic carpet that's used in that show. The mechanism, I guess, that's used to move that carpet around, 7,000 pounds. Like, wow. moving that thing was a production in and
of itself. That doesn't even make sense, because you can get a real flying carpet and they only weigh like 12 pounds.
Where do you get that?
Right.
Flying carpets are us?
GD sews them together himself.
Well, they are handmade. I don't make them. I just am like a third-party person who sells them. I don't
So where is this Washington Pavilion? In what city? Where is it located?
It's in Sioux Falls. It's one of the, you know, nicer venues in Sioux Falls. It's
Washington Pavilion. Like now, has George Washington ever slept there?
No.
Because he slept a lot of places. You know that. They say he slept everywhere, which is impossible. Everywhere you go, Washington slept here. You don't. So what is why is it named after Washington? Just because he was the first president? You don't know.
Because there's a lot of presidential stuff here in South Dakota.
You're supposed to learn about these things. Wherever you go, you need to learn about these things.
Right.
Why is it called this?
So South Dakota has Mount Rushmore. So like there's
Mount Rushmore?
Like a real presidential motif in this state.
Mount Rushmore.
I slept on top of Mount Rushmore once.
Mount Rushmore. No,
it's illegal.
No, you didn't.
Yes, I did.
You're lying.
No.
You're a terrible liar.
I am a terrible liar, but I did it.
You're an awful, rotten person.
He was trying to find Nicholas Cage's secret entrance.
Yeah.
I was 17. I didn't even know there was a Nick Cage. Or secret entrance.
Hey, Nick Coppola, by the way.
Yeah, true.
Nick Coppola. So this Washington Pavilion.
He's always maintained that he did that because he didn't want people to associate him with Francis Ford Coppola.
That's
but
nice.
I think it was Francis's request, like, no. Like, let's change this name, sir. Your acting is bad enough that I don't want the association.
Wow, really? You think he's a bad actor? Is he a bad actor?
No, I'm kidding. I'm just giving him crap.
I'll say, no, it's more like his.
I've been a Nicolas Cage fan since Raising Arizona.
What about, I think his first movie was Valley Girl, right? Valley Girl.
You don't think, like, Raising Arizona was his?
Raising Arizona was wonderful.
I never saw it.
Yeah.
Never saw it.
Oh, okay.
I never saw any movies. Name a movie. I haven't seen it.
Well, okay. I'm not going to tell you to go back and watch Raising Arizona.
I'm not going
to
go back.
The Godfather 4.
I've seen it. I actually have seen it.
Actually, it was done in claymation. It was really nicely done in claymation.
Yeah. Speaking of claymation, Jake Jolly will be with me tomorrow night doing
that. That's the guy who did it. He did Godfather 4.
No, he didn't. No, he didn't.
Don't believe me.
I know Jake, and I know he did. Jake is not a Godfather fan.
He did it in claymation. No. Now you're going to call me a liar.
I already called you a liar. I called you a dirty, rotten liar.
To my face. I can't believe this.
Yeah.
Wait till Jake comes.
Now I was going to offer you a free screening of Clay Zombie Christmas, which Jake is going to be talking about tomorrow night. It debuts, I think, next week.
Wait a minute, but tomorrow night's the Republican debate. I don't know if I can miss the debate to watch that.
Uh huh. Well, who can you name the four people debating?
Well, they already have names. Vivek Ramaswamy. Chris Christie, the lady chick, Nikki Haley, and Ron too short to be a candidate, and really, really short on ethics, DeSantis.
Very good. You named all four. Very good. I don't think Willie could have done that. I don't think he could. I don't think really cares about the Republican debate. Neither do I, really.
I named him in order of complexion.
I was just thinking about what's going on Twitter.
What is going on Twitter? You know what's going on Twitter? This is interesting. Last night, as cops in Arlington, Virginia were about to do a search warrant. I can't even think of it. Enforce a search warrant. The house blew up. Totally blew up. I mean, blew up like a nuclear bomb hit it.
Like special effects.
That's one way to get rid of the evidence.
But you're not going to hear anything about that on the news now. And you haven't heard. It hasn't been a news story. But you only know about this stuff if you're on Twitter. But so, cop, what was the search warrant for? We don't know. But it seems very
fireworks.
Weird. Fireworks. I think fireworks are legal in Virginia, by the way.
They were looking for explosives.
Yeah. I think we found them. Yeah.
Just before we bring our first guest in, I got to play a commercial before we bring them in. But, you know, I've been thinking about getting out of this congressional race. And I'm pretty sure I'm gonna bail out. There are, I think, 40 people who have registered as independent to run in this thing.
But it's just insane. Hang on. I have to say though, I really, really feel that the more candidates, especially if there's a bunch of independent candidates as well, I mean that's better for you because that spreads out the vote.
Well, here's the thing. Some of them, at least six of them, have military experience and all that kind of stuff, and people love that. I have none.
You need me to do some recon on those guys? I'll go.
Try to find dirt on them and like?
I'll do like some Marine face painting.
They're all spreading eye syphilis from the hookers they met.
Well. Willie, when you do the Marine face painting, make sure you use the brown camouflage.
Comes back to that.
Oh. And just because somebody's ex-military doesn't mean that they are a good candidate. I mean, the white supremacist groups are full of ex-military people.
I'm not saying that's necessarily a good thing, but I think people who vote, that matters with them. That sways, you know.
Not if we dig up dirt on them.
No, we dig up dirt on them, but
yeah,
that's a lot of people.
We don't have to dig up dirt. All we gotta do is make up dirt.
Yeah, I was gonna say. I mean, it's not. Listen, I don't know if anybody's listening to this podcast, but it's not like what we say.
Well, John is
true.
John Small is listening.
Right now, the thing is, I think you guys know I'm pretty overwhelmed with trying to run this dopey small business as it is. And to get involved with all that it takes to run a campaign with no money, to end up just like losing pathetically and be the only one who votes for myself. And I'm not even in my own district, so I can't vote for myself. So it just seemed like a waste of time. And so I'm thinking about
you can't get the carpetbagger vote?
Well, here's the thing. The Washington City Council candidate who didn't vote for himself. He didn't vote.
Lost by one vote?
Lost by one vote.
That's fucking awesome. You deserve, if you're too dumb to not vote for yourself, like then you don't, I mean, you definitely don't deserve to win.
He said
you're not
going
to vote. It's just like, people used to, I have a tendency to like my own posts or laugh at my own posts and stuff like that. And people were like, that's weird that you do that. It was like, if I don't like it, why should you?
He said it would be it would be narcissistic for him to vote for himself. Well, it did. I mean, it would have been a tie. He wouldn't have won. It would have been a tie if he had voted. Anyway.
And at that point, they would have fought to the death in the
coin toss.
Right. Let's play a commercial, and then we'll come back and we'll meet what Willie already has met and knows, Big John Small. But we'll play a little bit of Creative Live. You know, you can get 70% off right now up until, I believe, Christmas Eve is when this thing ends. It's 70% off discount for Coffee with the Dog listeners. So check it out. Yeah.
It's time to unleash your creative excellence. Dreams won't work if you don't. They never happen overnight, and they rarely follow a straight line. Excellence is a result of the hustle, consistently pushing to do better. And success looks different for everyone. CreativeLive.com charts paths and tailors content for students, but they also encourage independent thinking and exploration. Go outside of your comfort zone. Who knows? You might actually like it. Right now, you can get up to 70% off through this exclusive offer for Coffee with the Dog. CreativeLive.com has site-wide sale for Coffee with the Dog listeners. Save up to 70% off. Go to MindDogTV.com and click on the link on the homepage now.
And this is an opportunity to remind you that black screens matter. Yes, it is. Black screens matter. Big John Small is a clean comic out of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, not Sioux City, Iowa, which is really just a ripoff of Sioux Falls, South Dakota. It's just what That's they want to be. It's a pretend city. He's also the host of, what is it, John and Heidi on Sunny Radio? Yeah. Let's welcome him in right now and say hello to Big John Small. Good morning, Big John.
Hey, guys. How you doing?
We're doing well. Thank you for getting up. I don't know if getting up. You're up early anyway. You're doing morning show, right?
Yeah, I get up early, but I had to like put on somewhat nice clothes today. And I combed my hair. You can't even tell, but...
You put on somewhat nice clothes. Are you looking to your left, I guess it is, and at those guys? I mean, you put on somewhat...
I'm just saying, I look somewhat decent for me anyway.
You look like you're wearing a tuxedo compared to them.
Well, I'm just saying, usually people can only hear me, so I can literally be in here dressed however I want, but that's today...
Are you on the air right now?
I am, but I pre-recorded, so I could focus solely on this. So.
Wonderful. Now, do you do that every day, pre-record your show?
I do. I would never put my wife on live. Yes, if you ever meet my wife, you'll know why. We almost got banned in Canada, so...
I have my own wife. I understand why.
And that was something that slipped through the cracks and did go out. And imagine if I let her, say what she wants to say, we'd be in all kinds of trouble.
Now, don't you have a 7-second delay or something like that? Or?
The thing that we had to apologize in Canada. Do you remember when the Harvey Weinstein thing first broke?
Yeah.
Like, because there was a time 7, 8, 9 years ago where most people never heard of Harvey Weinstein. Like he was, doing stuff, but we didn't know. He was behind the scenes. So all of a sudden there's a story that he's doing, the stuff that he was doing. And one of the first stories that I remember coming out of that whole thing was there was a story about Meryl Streep. And Meryl Streep stepped up and said, hey, I've known Harvey Weinstein for a long time, and I've never had that kind of experience with Harvey Weinstein. So I'm reading this on the air, and my wife goes, well, of course she didn't. She's Meryl Streep. Who would want to rape Meryl Streep? And somebody called the Canadian government. They didn't call the radio station in Canada, because we're on a bunch of stations, but some in Canada. They didn't call the radio station to complain. They called the government. The government reached out to the radio station and said, you need to issue an apology.
Wait a minute. Meryl Streep called the government?
Meryl Streep didn't. Somebody who listens to the radio in Canada called and complained.
Who else has that kind of clout that they can just call the government other than Meryl Streep? I mean, there are people in Canada.
Well, you got it. It's Canada. It's not like a real country.
Oh, okay.
The thing that was fascinating,
Wait a minute. I'm sorry. Well, I have to interrupt just one second. Yeah. Matt, did you forget that like 97% of all of your fans are in Canada?
I love Canada. Canada is the best country on the planet, by the way. But
it's not a real country.
Right.
Okay. I love Canada too. Nothing against them. And we're on a couple stations there. So hi, guys.
Yeah.
And but when the radio station owner reached out and said, hey, oh, man, I got in all kinds of trouble over that and we have to issue an apology. And my wife said, we can record an apology. And it's like, would you do that? And she goes, yeah, we can record a thing that says, everyone should want to rape Meryl Streep. And he's like, we'll just do it here. We'll take care of that here. We're good. And then the same radio station owner, I got a call from him. And this was a phone call. He called me and goes, oh, you're killing me, John. You're killing me, Smalls. Our last name is Small, by the way. And he said, you're killing me. He goes, I can't believe it. Today on the radio, I'm going to get in so much trouble. I was like, for what? He goes, yeah, the F word on the radio. You can't do that. I'm thinking, what? Again, not that I never say that, but, I'm a clean comic. We do a pretty clean, family-friendly show, and I'm trying to figure out, when did this happen? Every Tuesday, I have my father-in-law, my wife's dad, comes on the show. It's called Tuesdays with Charlie, and it all started because we talked to him one time, like, 15 years ago, and it was so funny that we just started doing it every week. And how, think about a radio feature. Who would call their father-in-law every week? And how much fun could that be? It is so much fun. But he, during his segment, he was talking about, he's the one that said the F word. Now, I bleep him all the time because he does swear all the time. But I always bleep him. So nothing ever gets past the goalie here. Well, this time it did, because you know what the F word is in Canada?
No.
What?
He goes, yeah, he said fart. You can't say that on the radio in Canada. I said, the F word in Canada is fart? Like, we have a whole different F word in the United States.
Wow.
You know, I was having questions about why your wife got in trouble for asking what seems, or, you know, for saying what seems to be a...
Oh, no. I have no question.
Who would want to rape Meryl Streep? I agree with that question. I think that's a fair question.
That's a terrible question. She got in trouble for that. That's an awful question. It's an awful question, because it implies that rape is about how attractive you are and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, right. There's nothing good about race.
I thought it was about clout, and Meryl Streep is very powerful. That's what I'm thinking.
That's what I think, too. I mean, Meryl Streep seems like the woman, because Harvey Weinstein didn't, you know, throw people down and rape them. He seduced them with power, and by the time he got around to her, she was already well enough established that she would stand up to him, and I think
that was how I took it. I think that's what my wife meant as well. You don't fuck with Meryl Streep, plain and simple.
Yeah, there you go.
You'd have to have my kind of clout to do that.
Right.
Weinstein, please.
So John, now Sunny Radio, is that simulcast to other stations?
No, so our radio station is an AM station with an FM translator, and you can listen on the internet, sunnyradio.com. But then our radio show is pushed out to a bunch of other stations as well. So,
They have a great military following also.
Yeah, we do. Our slogan in Sioux Falls is faith, freedom, and the best music of the 80s and 90s. So we, you know, try to kind of fill a little void that we had found here, and it's been good. We've enjoyed that.
So you don't play any of my band stuff then, because that's when my band was in the 80s and 90s. So
nice.
He said best, not worst.
Yeah, that's what he said, best, not very best.
Hey, and it really is the best music of the 80s and 90s, because I've listened to that station before, and I heard the theme song for Greatest American Hero on 93.3. Believe it or not.
And yet you did not commit suicide, which is really commendable.
I have a question real quick. That foamy stuff behind your head.
Yeah, that's right.
Did you put that up because you knew you were going to be talking to Willie and you just banging your head like this?
I have a whole bag of these things. We moved into this studio, I don't know, like 2 months ago. And this is how much I put up. And then I was like, we're good. I think we're good. I have a whole bag of them in the other room.
Supposed to do the whole room.
They're not very well.
Come by and do that. I got time.
What you got? Like a stapler? Is that like a GM stapler?
I took one push pin. There's one push pin right there.
For all of you?
Yeah. I did not finish this project. I have ADHD and I get busy with it, and then I stop. This is as far as I got, and then I was done with that. So.
It doesn't seem to have affected the sound out of that microphone. Very very high quality and very dry. You're not getting a lot of bounce. It's kind of like unnecessary anyway. But
exactly, that's why I was like, I'm probably good. I don't think I need much more.
Yeah. Was radio always in your plan? I mean, was that always what you wanted to do?
So when I was first born, I didn't think much of radio because I was an infant. But as I started to grow, I was always a bit of a smart aleck. And I learned at an early age. I'm one of six kids, you know, I'm the middle child. I learned at a pretty early age that I could make people laugh and it felt good. So I'm like, oh, hey, you know, when I do that, that's a good reaction. Because usually I would make people mad and I'd get, you know, beat up. That's not a good reaction.
Was your comedy of choice as a child like slapstick, or did you use like puns, or what did you do to make people laugh?
Probably more along the lines of puns, but I would just find a way to take whatever scenario was happening in our messed up life, and I would find a way to make people laugh. And I remember one time my dad didn't laugh. We were being noisy upstairs, and my dad was a bigger guy. He hardly ever came upstairs in our house, and he said, he goes, "You guys be quiet up there. If I hear another peep, I'm coming up there." And I said so quietly, there's no way he could have heard it. I said, "Peep." And my brother and my other brother kind of chuckle a little bit. And my dad goes, I heard that, John. I'm like, oh, no.
Wow. He could tell which kid was being a smartass. Oh, that's good.
He knew.
Well,
he
probably because the giggles of the other ones, like, implicated him. Yeah.
So when I was in high school, I grew up watching Johnny Carson. Like, I love Johnny Carson. And I would watch his show at least for the first 10 minutes, because then I would catch the monologue. I'd find out, you know, the monologue. And sometimes I'd stay up a little later and I'd watch whoever the guest was, but I would always watch him come out. He would deliver the monologue, stand-up comedy, different comedy every single night. Now, think about how many comics we know as stand-up comics. They tell the same jokes for like a year at a time. So they have a chance to hone that in. They come out and they do a special and they do a tour. And for like a whole year, they're telling the exact same set. Johnny Carson would come out every single night and do a completely different set. Now, I understand he had writers. He wasn't writing all of the stuff. But he would deliver it in such a way that even if the joke didn't get a laugh, he would find a way to make the fact that it didn't get a laugh, he would make that funny.
Oh, yeah.
So he was just so talented.
He was really good at that.
He perfected the craft of telling bad comedy and making it good comedy. Yeah.
Well, and just, you know, again, finding a way to make the mundane things funny. And So when I was a kid, I this was my path that I thought I was going to have.
Right.
I also really liked Saturday Night Live. So as a kid, I thought I am going to get on Saturday Night Live and then I'm going to host The Tonight Show. So Jimmy Fallon is living the life that I thought I wanted. But I'll tell you, 100% God's honest truth, I wouldn't want that life today. Not even a little bit.
I've been to New York.
I've been to L.A. I wouldn't want to live in either of those places. They're wonderful places. There's probably some people watching from there. Hi, guys. Love you. Just can't handle that town, either one of those, because there's, you know, I'm from a small town. I'm like a country mouse. I couldn't be in a city.
No, if I'm being honest, I'm kind of jealous of the life that you have. I mean, I would love to have a radio show in the middle of the country somewhere. You know, I love radio, but I can't imagine for somebody who loves it, to make people laugh. And that's because on radio, you don't hear the laughter. You don't get any feedback.
None.
It's got to be trying to be funny. You know it's funny, but there's still that need to hear people laugh.
And that's where the beautiful thing with like the program that we do, it's my wife and me. So it's the two of us. So my favorite sound in the whole wide world is the sound of my wife laughing. It really, truly is.
Yeah. Right.
So and when it's a genuine laugh, here's the other thing that's kind of cool about the John and Heidi show. There's a lot of people out there, you know, like Bob and Miffy or whatever, you know, and Miffy's job is literally she gets paid to laugh at Bob no matter what he says.
Right.
And I know a lady who used to work with, I'm not going to say the real names, but a lady who used to work with a guy, and she didn't stay there very long. And I asked her, it was a big station. It had a good following. And I'm like, why didn't you stay? And she said, I couldn't work with him anymore because he would read this stupid story and he would point at me. And then he said, when I point at you, you laugh. And then she's like, so I have to do these stupid fake laughs. And she's like, people are going to think I'm a moron. Why would you laugh at that? That wasn't funny. She's like, I just couldn't do it. You know, he'd be reading a story and he would point at me. And literally, it's like, you laugh now. And now you laugh now. And now you laugh now. If I tried that with my wife, well, we'll just say it wouldn't work.
Yeah, if I did that with my wife, I'd say, you laugh now. I would go, you laugh now, and this is what I draw back. And be like, you laugh now. Oh, shit. Okay.
You don't have to
laugh. Yeah, you don't have to laugh anymore. Yeah.
Why
pretty
not
soon just, is this? I don't have any fingers left.
That's right.
Yeah, why not just tape her laugh and have it on a button?
Exactly. And if that's all you want is some mindless, you know, canned laughter, even if it's live, it's still canned if they're pointing at you to make it happen.
Absolutely.
Right, yes.
Well, to be fair, now coming back to Johnny Carson, I've sat there enough in that audience. That
the applause signs.
The applause and the laughter sign, you know.
Yeah.
So. Yeah. I mean, it's pretty much the same thing, but, you know.
Well, and for me, you were saying, you know, to be in a room talking to yourself, you guys do the same thing where you're at, you know, you're doing the kind of like doing a radio show. And I know you can see each other on the screens, but the thing that's nice is having my wife in the studio. And when I'm reading a story and I'm making her laugh with my silly joke, then I just assume, even though her sense of humor is weird like mine, so I assume that if she's laughing, hopefully other people are laughing. But one of the things that I think was really fun feedback, I talked to a lady. She said, I love listening to you and your wife on the radio, and your relationship is similar to my husband and I. And I was like, oh, you have a bad marriage too? So she said it was really cool because, like, you were reading this story that I could tell from the sound of your voice. You thought it was really funny, and then you had this silly comment at the end, and instead of your wife laughing, she went, lame. And she said, I laughed so hard when they did that.
That was
exactly what I would have done to my husband.
Yeah, yeah. My wife does not think anything I do that is funny. Me trying to be funny is not funny to her. She laughs at me trying to not be funny, trying to be like normal. All that kind of stuff. Now, has your wife ever done a stand-up comedy? No?
No, she, as a kid, funny thing is, she also wanted to be on Saturday Night Live, and she wanted to do stand-up comedy. And when she was a little kid, she would pretend to have a radio station. And we've got a cassette tape. She and her brother were recording on a cassette tape. And the fake radio station that they had was KZOY. I have no idea why an eight-year-old Heidi would have dreamed up those call letters. So when we were buying our radio station, she said, I wonder if those call letters are available. I'm like, I'm pretty sure they will be. It's about the dumbest call letters I've ever heard. It means nothing. So our station is KZOY. It just rolls off the tongue, doesn't it?
I'm just amazed. I'm kind of sad for your wife that she didn't get to do the Saturday Night Live thing. And you either, because I think the two of you could have met on Saturday Night Live and gotten married.
Yeah.
And had a good marriage as opposed to the one you have now.
We actually do have a good marriage.
I just want to explain that today is CD's last show on the program. So pretty much disregard anything he says.
I didn't even get to ask the other questions that I wrote down.
That's fine.
We actually are approaching 24 years we've been married. We've been together over 24 years now. But we had both been married before and then both divorced. And something you guys were talking about before I came on, you were talking about the election and somebody who didn't vote for themselves.
Right.
And when my wife and I got married, I had a bunch of political books just because I was kind of interested in politics. And she had a son from a previous marriage. And at the time, he was 2 when we met. But when we got married, I moved in. He's 3. And he's a smart kid. Now he's 27. But he was super smart. He taught himself to read when he was 3. I mean, I don't know many people who do that. And it wasn't like little words.
How do you teach yourself to read?
He just said, I just sounded it out. But he was like reading stuff. And he was looking at these books. These are not kids' books. These are political books. And he said, is this Roosevelt? And I said, it's Roosevelt. And he goes, shouldn't Rose be R-O-S-E? I'm like, yeah, it should be. 3-year-old. It should be, but for whatever reason, we say Roosevelt, not Roosevelt. It probably would have been Roosevelt.
3-year-olds have better logic than the Roosevelt, people who designed the English language.
Yeah. Super smart kid, but he got very interested in politics. He's been on the early show, and he's been on a bunch of other channels. When he was a little kid, he decided he was going to run for president in 2032. So he made the rounds, got to do all kinds of fun stuff. But the thing that was fascinating, when all that happened, his biological father, who's never really been a part of his life, he chose to not be a part of his life. He decided he was going to get involved in politics. And he ran for mayor of the small town that he lives in Iowa. And the only reason I know that is because somebody sent us a clip from the newspaper. They had the election results. He owned a bar at that time in this town. So he thought, I'm going to run for office. You know, people coming into my bar, they're going to vote for me. And his mother lived there, and he lived there, and all of his friends lived there. And the election results came out. He got 2 votes in the entire town. Yeah. So that means either he voted for himself and his mother voted for him and none of his customers did, or a couple customers did and his mom didn't. I'm just like going, I can't even imagine. I felt so bad for the guy. I don't dislike him. I'm like, dude, I'll buy you a beer. That really sucks.
Is that what you're afraid of, Matt, getting 2 votes?
No votes would be, because I can't even vote for myself. I'm not in that district. So there is a real possibility I would get no. I think Jackie would vote for me. Jackie's in that district.
can you run in the district if you don't live there?
Yes. George Santos, the guy who had the seat up until last week, never lived in that district. Never in his life. He lived near me.
That's how does that work? Where you can run for, so I can run for office in a district I don't live in.
For Congress, yeah, and not for senator. You have to live in the state if you run for senator. You have to live in the state, obviously, if you're going to run for Congress as a representative for New York State. But
in South Dakota, we have one, so the entire state is the whole same district.
That's one.
Wow.
Yeah.
There's less than a million people here, bro. I mean, that's.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Now, we can have everybody over for dinner, like the whole state.
If I could backtrack just for a second now, K-Zoy.
Yeah.
K-Z-O-Y. You own the station?
Yeah, we started the station in 2010. Yeah.
Okay. Now, typically marketing departments like to work with whatever, like the dog or you know, the zoo or any K-Rock, things like that. Yeah. That's a marketing tool. How do you market K-Zoy? You're like,
we just pretend that it's not even called that. We just call it Sunny. It's Sunny Radio.
K-Zoy.
Yeah. Now, should it be Snowy Radio?
Snowy Radio we have as well. That's our Christmas channel. So, seriously, snowyradio.com.
Because I think of South Dakota. That's all I think about is snow. I don't know. It just seems like it seems like it might as well be Canada.
Yeah, pretty close.
Are you still doing stand-up? Do you still go out to clubs and do stand-up?
Yeah. I don't do as much going to comedy clubs. Not that I can't do that, but for me, the thing that I love to do is I love doing like nonprofit events. So this last Friday, I did a fundraiser for Feeding South Dakota, and I didn't plan that event. A young man named Bryson planned that. He did such a good job. He was 19 years old when he started working on this plan. And he turned 20 before the event happened. But I mean, he put together a really nice fundraiser, asked if I would help. And I said, of course, I'll gladly help. And then the next night I was in a town, Aberdeen, South Dakota. And up in Aberdeen, South Dakota, we raised money for the Aberdeen Area Foster Closet. And that was an event that I helped pull together. And it was a really fun time. So I love doing that. And I do, you know, I even do like I did some shows at a church last year. And one of the nonprofit events that we did, or a fundraiser event at a church last year, we raised $12,000 for the church. Wow. So, good you for know, you. To me, I love doing that. And
I think it's really important for people in show business, or really whatever business, but to connect with something that gives back, and not for the outcome that it will. It will help you grow your career and do whatever. I've been a volunteer. People know this about me since I was 16 years old and do a lot of volunteer work. But I think it's really important for anybody to understand the benefit of giving back and what you get out of it just from a personal experience. And then often that will come back to show results in your professional life. No, it hasn't with this program necessarily, but it does.
I've always enjoyed, and for me, that's maybe one of my a downfall for me as well, because my wife, she's like, you know, you could make a profit, because like when I'll do these events, I figure out all the expenses and I get sponsors to cover everything, so it's all covered. She's like, so why not raise a little more and like make something on this event? I was like, yeah, I suppose I could, but
yeah, I like to keep those things separate. I have no problems with capitalism or making money. Yeah. I like that.
Same here. Yeah.
But the idea of keeping charitable work separate from profitable work. I don't know. I just prefer it that way. Earlier you were talking about comedians doing the same material over and over again. And I think there's a really good upside to that is that you get to perfect your act. And last night I was listening to Barry Katz, and he was talking about his first encounter with Bobcat Goldthwait in 1980. It was Goldthwait's first time at a club in Boston, and Barry was reciting his work, and it's like, that's the same act I saw him doing 7 years later, doing the exact same material. But there is some...
And if you're doing it for a different audience, you can do that. You know, if you're going from place to place to place.
Right.
I was thinking of this the other night. Think about, because I have a lot of friends that are musicians, and I've got a lot of friends that are comics. And I kind of feel bad for my comic friends because they have to constantly churn out new material. If I come around, you know, every year and I do the same exact comedy show for the same people every year, eventually they'd be like, I'm not going to that. I've seen him tell those same jokes 12 times, you know, so they got to have new material all the time. But on the reverse side, if a band comes to town and they don't play the song you want them to play, you're upset.
Yeah.
You're like,
yeah.
What is this new crap? Play the stuff we know. Play the hits, man. And I'm like, how weird is it that it's, you know,
I think that's a mindset thing because, and I've talked about this quite a bit. Rodney Dangerfield, I saw him five times,
yeah,
four times, and every time he did the same material, and people knew his hits, and they were like, but Al Baker, who was a sleight of hand magician that I learned from when I was a kid, he defined the difference between amateur and professional for me, and it sticks in my mind, and I'll take this to the grave. Not that it holds true for everybody, but he said an amateur is somebody who needs to go to the magic shop and get new tricks to do for new audiences all the time, and a professional is somebody who does the same material for different audiences all the time. And
I agree with that because I think that that's actually not as true as people make it. I think that what needs to happen in order for you to be able to write better jokes, like, and perfect that joke. Because, like, I think about, like, John Mulaney. I can't tell you how many times I've listened to New Kid in Town. I've listened to that album, that comedy album, at least 20 times. And I laugh every time. You know what I mean? Like, and so it's like
for the same reason.
What do you mean for
the same reason? Same
because
yeah.
What I'm saying is
because
like,
I enjoy the jokes. Like I want to hear those again. You know, when the material is strong, like and think about like the Blue Collar Tour. You know what I mean? Like those guys, and Ron White. There's at least. Because I used to, anytime I saw a Ron White DVD, I grabbed it. And there was overlap in almost every one of those, at least for a couple of bits. You know what I mean? Because your bread and butter is your bread and butter.
Yeah.
You know, and funny's funny, you know?
The danger here with all of that, you know, because as a musician, I can tell you, I am one of these guys who we play the same songs in the same order sometimes every show, and it gets to be you have to push yourself to deliver it with the same energy because you find it boring. You've done it so many times that it becomes, you know, rote, and then you have to really dig down deep and say, I gotta make this feel like this is new to me, because you know it's new to the audience, but it's a difficult thing. So that, you know, I compare music to comedy too much and overanalyze things. But I think sometimes in the mind of comedians, they get to the point where they think they have to continually write stuff, and there's nothing wrong with that. But there is also a big benefit of something that really works. You know, this bit kills. Stick with that bit until it doesn't kill anymore. Until
absolutely,
people, right. You know.
Well, one of the differences I find with music and comedy is that, and like you, I've done both. I have been unsuccessful as a musician, and I've been unsuccessful as a comedian. So I've done both. Is that with music, like, for example, I love the song Young Lust. But there's a moment in my life where Young Lust meant something because of some young lady I was young lusting with. And so I don't hear that. It's not like I was like making out with to sound like to a Bill Cosby album, you know.
Yeah.
So it's like, but I could be making out to a Barry White album. You know what I'm saying? But so to me, it's like a different thing as where you can enjoy music as to where you can enjoy comedy and the kind of memories they bring back. So there may be a moment where you're like, I can hear this song over and over again, and it takes me back to a place. But as far as comedy goes, it's generally you hear it, you laugh.
Yeah.
And that's it. It's just it's like an explosion. Comedy is like an explosion, and music is like a memory, at least the way I process it.
Absolutely. When you were talking about Young Love, that made me think. The other day I was listening to our radio station driving down the road, and the song Sexy and 17 came on. And I was thinking, first of all, when was that ever okay? Because apparently it was in the 80s, under 18. But do they still sing that song in concert now that they're in their 50s?
Now, who was that? That's Stray Cats, right? Sexy and 17.
I think it was, I was thinking it was Skid Row, but I don't know. I don't remember who it was.
Yeah, they did it when K-Bad had that venue where they were doing a bunch of rock shows and whatever.
Yeah.
Because I watched that in prison because there was a local channel that played a lot of their concerts and stuff. And so they totally played that song. And I remember thinking, that's fucking weird.
Do you think Ringo Starr wouldn't still be playing She's 16, She's Beautiful and She's Mine?
Or, I don't know.
And was that Sweet Caroline, which was written about a young 13, 14-year-old girl?
Yeah,
that's still, right. Yeah.
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 Stray Cats.
Stray Cats, there we go. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah.
So I don't know which song Stray Cats has to, because
Stray Cats has to, because they only have like 3 hits, right? No, I'm just teasing. They may have 4.
3 or 4, yeah, 3 or 4.
I just failed music trivia about music I play on my own radio station.
Well, I think there's a similar title because there's Kip Winger had a song about that. She's only 17. There's a whole so much of them. You know, yeah. 17 seemed to be the magic age. Listen, when I was 18 or 19. 17 was it was like the time when a banana goes from green to yellow. It was ripe.
Yeah. And it's different when you're 19, but you know, that's what I was saying. Now that they're in their 50s, I wonder if they were still saying that.
That's what, yeah.
She's only 47.
Beyond 47.
So I see you guys have Greg Warren coming up. I've had him on our program twice. He's a great dude.
Yeah, he, like you, works clean, which baffled the hell out of me.
So I did an interview with him in 2020, and he had an album coming out. And it was right as his album was coming out that the pandemic happened. And he's like, I had a whole tour that just got canceled.
Right.
So I told him, I said, here's my idea. Get a flatbed truck and go out and do shows on a flatbed truck with like a little FM transmitter. And I said, just drive around in the Midwest. There's nothing else to do. People would come. I said, do a free show, but get it sponsored by like Pioneer Seeds or somebody that I said, go on, do free shows and have it where you get paid to do it. And then, you know, people come and shine their headlights and watch you standing on a flatbed truck.
Yeah.
He did not do it. I asked him in the next interview I did when he did the thing with Nate Bargatze, the salesman.
Yeah.
I had the same idea.
A couple shows like that in the parking lot.
That's what Nate Media is, right? Bargatze's
Nate Bargatze. Yeah, we've had him on our program too. He's a good dude. Very good dude.
I'm jealous. I would love to talk to Nate. Of course, he's the biggest star in the world right now. I waited too long to even try to get him because
the thing that's kind of fun, a lot of the stuff that we've had a chance to do, it's because I didn't know I wasn't supposed to do it, so I just did it.
Yeah.
In like 2017, my wife and I were at an event called 80s in the Sand. Now it's just called the Sands. And I did interviews with 3 movie stars from the 80s. So Diane Franklin, Amanda Wiss, and Curtis Armstrong. Curtis played Booger on Revenge of the Nerds. And
oh, my God. Anyways,
so I record these interviews. And on the way home, I remember we're sitting in the airplane. I remember she had like earphones in. And I nudge her and she pulls out one of her little earbuds. I said, I've got an idea. She's like, what? What's your idea? I said, I've got these interviews. I'm going to start a new feature called Movie Star Monday. She's like, okay, what's that? I'm like, I'm going to talk to a different movie star every single Monday. She said, you have 3 interviews. I'm like, yeah, the first 3 weeks are done. And she goes, so when do you think you're going to talk to others? I'm like, I'm going to line it up. And she put her earbuds back in and just completely ignored me the rest of the flight. It's like, there's no way that's going to happen. Here's the thing.
It totally has, though.
It has. Every single Monday, I've got different people from movies. Now, there are times that movie star might be a bit of a stretch, but I've had Jamie Lee Curtis. I've had Ed Asner. I've had some amazing guests, and I've got some that I've kind of built a relationship with, and then I just say, hey, what's that?
Tracy Lords.
No.
He works clean.
Yeah, but she doesn't have to.
Have you had Shane Tweed on the show yet?
I think we got Asner coming up to take GD's place, even though he's already dead.
So here's the thing that's funny. I don't even know who that is, but I got a feeling I know who that is. So.
Yeah. I don't want to go into explaining it today.
No, but it was really cool because I just say, hey, we're going to do this every Monday. And then I start. So I guess my advice to anybody out there is, you know, like, dream big and do it. And if somebody tells you you can't do it, just don't let them get in your way of you going out and doing it.
Because, absolutely. Yeah, but how much work is that on you to actually try to... Because I know from me how difficult it is to get big stars on the program. Now, Diane Franklin, actually, she's in a movie with my guest tomorrow night. He produced the movie. It's an independent film. But in the 80s, she was like the It Girl or something. She was,
you know, she was Monique from the movie Better Off Dead.
Right.
She was the French foreign exchange student. She was in an Amityville movie. She was in, you know, a bunch of stuff. She's one of the princesses in Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventures.
Right.
So she was in a ton of stuff. And she's a sweetheart. She's just like the kindest, nicest lady ever.
I know that. But how much work is it on you to actually, how much time are you devoting to trying to book these Monday guests now?
In the beginning, it was a lot of work. Yeah, and I'll give you my little secret that didn't really... It didn't yield much of a result, but here's one of the things that I did. I went on to IMDb, and you can do like a premier membership or something like that. Right, and then it gives you all the information, like their PR people. And a lot of that was a waste of my time because most of the people didn't even respond. But that's how I got Ed Asner, the guy. And here I thought this was really cool. The guy that was in charge of doing the PR for Ed Asner, he responded to me, and he was an older guy, so he called me instead of emailing back, and he said, what is it you're trying to do? And I said, well, I'm doing this new feature, Movie Star Monday, and I'd love to visit with Mr. Asner. And he goes, okay. He goes, here's what I'm going to do. I've got some other guests that I want you to talk to first, and if you talk to them, I'll give you Ed.
Right.
So I was like, what a great agent. Here's all these people that, you know, are trying to get exposure. They're new. And what he didn't realize is I'm like, dude, instead of one, I just got 7 weeks worth of stuff.
No, I get it.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah,
thank you. Awesome. And some of those people turned into people that we all know now as well. We didn't know them then because they were brand new, but they were kind of the people to watch in Hollywood, right?
Right. So, very, very cool.
So now, back then it was hard to get, but now, honestly, I've got like seven Movie Star Mondays that I still haven't aired because I record them ahead of time. And so that is, I've been very, very, very blessed. And this time of year, everybody is in a Christmas movie and they all do interviews about the Christmas movies.
Right.
So between now and Christmas, it's going to all be people from a Christmas movie.
Who's the biggest movie star you've ever talked to on Movie Star Monday?
And again, the funny
You don't want to denigrate all the others.
No. But... And what it depends on who you are, you know, like, I think Jamie Lee Curtis probably is the biggest, but I had Pauly Shore, and I'm telling you what, I thought Pauly Shore, when I was a kid, he was like one of my favorite people.
Yeah, I love Pauly Shore.
Yeah. So there's, again, I don't know how you would really define the biggest.
Well, if you got Clint Eastwood, you would know that's the biggest one. Oh, if you had Kevin Costner, you would know that's the biggest star I've ever had. I mean,
my wife and our former coworker, he passed away this last year, but those two like to give me a lot of crap about this because, like, I've had Lou Ferrigno Jr.
Because the Lou Ferrigno might be the biggest star you've ever had.
Yeah, but it was his son who's also big, and he's in a bunch of movies. But Lou Ferrigno Jr. And then I've had David Hasselhoff's daughters, both of them, at different times. Wow. When I say that, I want to make sure I had them on the program. I want to make sure that sounded really bad.
Yeah, that's definitely where my mind went.
Michelle Pfeiffer's sister, I've had on the show.
An actress herself, right, Michelle?
Yeah, Dee Dee. And again, they're all famous. They're all in, you know, a Frank Stallone I've had on the program. Again, a lot of people that are in programs that they're huge, but then they just happen to have a sibling or a parent or somebody that's huger, you know, so they're kind of standing in their
Frank
shadows.
Stallone related to?
What's that?
Who's Frank Stallone related to?
He's Rambo.
Rambo Stallone. Okay, got it. Rambo Stallone.
My wife, my ex-wife, my first wife, was she worked for the Stallone family. They had a sandwich shop, Stallone's, and she knew Frank very well. Didn't know Sylvester, but knew Frank and the mother. The mother was kind of famous. She was had her own talk show for during the 80s or something. Yeah, so cool. Very cool. Very cool for you.
No, I've had a lot of fun, and I've had a chance to talk to like a bunch of my favorite comedians. And again, I feel very, very blessed. Like I said, didn't get to do the Tonight Show. Didn't get to do SNL, even though I did submit a tape to Saturday Night Live and they sent it back to me because I needed an agent and I didn't have one. So then my son found that tape and he made fun of it big time. So he's got it somewhere. I'm like, I need to get that back. He's like, no, I'm keeping this forever. So
now you are I hate to put the box on you, but a Gen X.
I think so. I don't know. Yeah. Probably.
So could the music from the 80s and 90s is your music?
Yeah.
Kiss had played their final concert. Were you a Kiss fan?
I've met them numerous times, seen them numerous times, and I guess I would say I'm a fan. Yeah.
Okay, because they had their last show the other night, and there was some big rumblings about it that they didn't make anything special. It was just like they just went out and played a concert.
Okay,
and
here's
it was
the thing.
Their last show
is
at
it
Madison
their last Park. Show for real? Think yeah, about I how many it. People do their farewell yeah. tour, and then like 10 years and later they do another again. Farewell tour.
That's that was the question I have. So is it really their last concert ever? But I think they are old enough that it could be.
But they did something. I thought they did something with AI as a part of it, so they can perform in perpetuity or something.
Yeah, but is that? I don't know if that's a thing. Is that a thing yet? Maybe that's a thing.
Well, that's just it. It's not a thing to us. But there's 10 years from now,
there's a hologram
now, it's going to be a thing to some
Jackson.
Kid. The same kids that are out there doing stupid shit now are going to be even dumber shit later.
Yeah. Well, the Rolling Stones are still out there and touring. So, you know, you never know. You never can say you're too old. As long as Keith Richards is still alive and playing, there's nobody who's, you can't say too old to be out rock and roll. But I do think it probably really is Kiss's last real show.
It could be. And they do a lot of good stuff. You know, they give back in a lot of big ways, and there's like foundations they're a part of. So like I said, I've talked to them numerous times, been a part of several things they've done, and they're good guys. Right. And they put on a heck of a show. I mean, they really do.
You own the station. Do you program all the music?
We do. Yeah, my wife and I do.
Is it automated or do you have DJs coming in? And
it's both. It's automated with DJs. So we have, in addition to our show being syndicated on a couple hundred stations, we have three other shows that we also syndicate, you know. So, and in the beginning, when we started doing that, every one of these shows was based in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, where we live. And then over the course of time, as people have moved on, when we replace them with somebody that was super talented, but not necessarily here. So we've got one person in Michigan, we've got one person in New York, we've got one person just outside of Chicago. So, you know, they're very talented people from other places.
Interesting. Now, because the 80s and 90s, there's so much diverse music from there. You could have Culture Club, you could have Rush, and those are not even in the same universe musically.
They are here.
They are. So you're basically playing anything from the 80s and 90s?
This truly happened one night. I was driving along, and even though I just got done saying a little bit ago how awful I was, I said the wrong band for the name of this song. Right. I was driving along listening to Motley Crue on our station, and then there was a little piece of imaging for Sunny Radio, and it went into Tiffany. And I remember thinking, in what universe, other than this one, do those two play back to back?
I love that.
And then Tiffany was followed by AC/DC, and I'm like, this is just the craziest thing, man.
Yeah. Well, on Mind Dog Radio, we have Frank Sinatra into Frank Zappa. So
I love that. I really do. I think that's awesome.
I heard that one night, and I was sitting in the hot tub, and I had Mind Dog Radio on. I heard Frank Sinatra, and the very next song was Frank Zappa. I was like, because it's all automated. Nobody's thinking about that. But what an unusual segue.
I do that kind of, that's one of the things when I do my Star Maker lives, that's one of the things I'm most proud of, is the variety of music. And I like to make hard turns. I like to make super hard turns in it. You know, like I'll go from singing like Jewel to like singing Godspeed. You know, like,
did you guys know?
For real, I've done that. I guarantee I've done that.
How do if I point there, is that, am I pointing to Will right now?
Yeah, yes, you are. Yeah.
I didn't know if I was the same on all of them. So did you know this guy just won a karaoke contest the other night?
I know. Congratulations on that, by the way. I forgot to say that before.
John's the one that told me about it, by the way. John's the reason I was there.
Did you get cash for that win? Because I know the one on the 29th,
yeah,
you get $1,000
for that one. $65 I won that night because I won the entrance fees. There was 13 performers, and so I won the $5 entrance fee that everybody paid for that night. And then so on the 29th, I'll have a chance. The first prize is $1,000. Second prize is $500, and third prize is $250. There is another chance to get into the finals on the 15th, by the way, in case anybody listening is in the Brandon area and wants to try.
That's a mistake, but you don't want anybody else getting into the competition.
I'm getting in. I'm competing with you.
No.
I'm coming too.
Awesome.
Do you sing, John?
You are, John.
Do you sing?
I do. Yeah, I'm not really going to compete with him. I don't want to do that.
All right.
But no, my wife number two was saying that she might try and get in it, and I was like, please do.
How many wives do you have?
I would love to crush you in this competition.
Like, how many wives do you have? That was your second wife.
Are you counting prison wives?
No, no. I didn't have any of those, GD. I'm on marriage number three is currently happening right now.
I did not realize that. That's cool. I'm on marriage number two.
Wow. So. Yeah. It happened.
The first one was like a starter, like you just test it out, and I'm like, nah, I'm gonna return. I'm gonna trade this in for a better one.
Right, so, I get it.
My first
How did you meet Willie?
Oh, I think we were in prison together. So no, we didn't.
I'm sure that's what most people would have assumed.
No, I met him doing stand-up comedy. And I remember when did he talk about why he was in prison? Did he ever talk about that on the show?
He's never mentioned it.
They're well aware.
So I just remember, because there, and you have to tell me, Will, if I get this right, but I remember you talking about that. And I think you said something like, I would have gotten away with it too if it wasn't for the Mylar balloons flopping out the window.
Yeah, that is part of the bit for sure.
And I remember laughing about that so hard. Like, I was still laughing about that when the next comic was going up. I'm like, I'm still laughing about that today. I thought that was like, there's some jokes, and I'm hoping that didn't really happen, did it? Did you really have
the Mylar balloons? No, not the balloon thing or anything, no. But that's part of what I'm talking about before. Like, the flower shop routine, like that stuff that if I do a big show like my long set and I don't do that, people are going to be mad at me. Yeah. People are going to be mad at me that I didn't do the flower shop stuff. I've had people bitch at me for not doing slow death as my
closer. You're very easy to be mad at.
I am easy to be mad
at. Now, Will, to be fair, most of them are mad at you because when you do slow death, you keep coming back. And you just don't stay dead.
I don't really die. I don't actually die.
Yeah, they're like,
come on. Die one of these times.
Yeah. It's like being funnier than Tom Segura. They'd be like, oh, come on. He didn't die.
Did you see? He's got a new fucking show where he's doing the news. Did you see that fucking bullshit?
Yeah.
He's found a way to capitalize on this, the internet. I mean, hats off to him, man. That's awesome.
I don't think he had to. And this is the biggest problem I have with him at punching down on poors, as he calls them. Anyway, he's a trust fund baby. He was rich from the day he was born. So he comes off like a self-made man, but he's not a self-made man. He's always had this. And Bert Kreischer goes on about how, you people don't know Tom wasn't always rich. His father basically was only sending him $10,000 a month instead of $100,000 a month. That's what he means by poor. So
we've had Birdie Boy on the program too. He's another one. I just love that guy.
Yeah. Now, the window you're in does not show how big you are. How big is Big John Small?
I'm a big guy. As of this morning, 342 pounds.
Wow. How tall?
I don't know, just under 6 foot.
Oh, under 6 foot.
Just wow. under 6 foot. Yeah,
I like would imagine you like 6'9" or something.
No, I'd love to be. That'd be great. Because then I probably would be like, you know, somewhat normal proportions.
You never.
So my wife and I are. We're starting a diet, and we're going to do it for real this time because we've done diets. This is one of my favorite things. We started the radio station. The newspaper did a photo of us, and they put it on the front page in the small town Brandon that we were in at the time. And local couple starts radio station. There's a picture of me, fat guy, and my wife on the front cover of the newspaper. And I get a call from a diet center, and they said, "Hey, I'd like to chat with you about advertising." And I go, "Oh, okay, cool. I'll come in and see you." And I get in there, and she goes, "What I would like to do is if you and your wife are interested in doing our program, we'll do it in exchange for advertising." And I'm thinking, what? Should I be offended by that? Like, yeah. Hey, fatty fatso, why don't you come in, waddle your ass in here and chat with me? Anyway, I was like, I'll gladly do that. So, yeah. So when I at the time, 2010, when we started that diet, I was 295 pounds. And we did the diet, and I got down to 230 pounds. And I lost so much weight so quickly, I literally had people didn't even know it was still me. I went in to see somebody like when we first started the station, and then I went back like 6 months later to see them because they told me to come back in the fall. And I come in, I'm chatting with them. They go, "Yeah, I talked to the owner this spring." And I'm like, "No, that was me." "No, it must have been the other owner." I'm like, "No, that was me. I talked to you. That was a bigger guy." I'm like, "That was me. I lost 65 pounds."
Yeah.
Yeah. But then we went back to what we were doing and we gained it back. And then we did that diet again. I lost weight and gained and lost and gained. And now we're going to do like for real. Going to do our thing. Then I got to get rid of half of my jokes, though, because most of my jokes are about me.
I was just going to bring that up. Barry Katz was talking about Louis Anderson last night and how Louis could not afford to eat, become healthy. Because he always started his show with fat jokes about himself to kind of, because listen, if you come in like he was very, very,
he was big. Yeah.
Yeah. The audience, it's like the elephant in the room.
So we tried to, I did an interview with him. His sister lives like 45 minutes from Sioux Falls. So I did an interview with him in 2020, maybe. He was doing a special from his living room, and I was booking a show for Snow Jam Comedy Festival. The last one is coming up this coming year, but we were looking for our headliner. And I said, "Hey, I'm talking to Louis Anderson. I'd love to have him." So they said, "Yeah, talk to him." So I asked him if he would like to come out. He goes, "You know, I would love to do that." But he goes, "This COVID thing." He's like, "Everything that COVID hates, I've got." I'm like, "Diabetic, I'm overweight, I'm getting old, like all these problems." He's like, I'm not doing anything outside of this house right now." And the thing that was really weird, he died during Snow Jam Comedy Festival.
Right.
So we had Dennis Regan as our headliner instead. I was having lunch with Dennis Regan, and there was a bunch of other comics. We're literally having lunch when I got a message that Louis Anderson passed away.
Yeah.
And I was like, "Oh man, that." So I remember.
If there's a moral to that story, it's
don't talk to John Small before you.
No, the moral is he should have come and hung out with us. He would have been safer here.
If you're gonna die anyway, you might as well go out having fun and doing what you. You know, sometimes
how much would it have sucked if he would have been in Sioux Falls when he died? Then I would have felt like I killed Louis Anderson.
I mean, that's true. You probably would feel a great sense of guilt. Like, "Oh man, he's not even scared, and I pushed him to come, and now
I talked him into it. Come on, Louis. How bad can it be?"
That's don't a valid concern. No, I'm not saying you should have talked him into it. But for him, for me, I'd rather die doing what I love than to be overly careful and die anyway.
Yeah.
In your house.
You know alone. What? That's actually why I always dream of going out while some girl is sitting on my face. I'd rather die doing what I love.
John, I have a question for you. You did a small business benefit. I mean, small business summit.
Yeah.
Okay. When you spoke there, now are these businesses that you own, small businesses, or are these small businesses as in limited funds and stuff?
No, I was the MC for the event. The Small Business Administration put on the event, and then they had people coming in to speak about, you know, how to make your small business more successful. They didn't have me speak about that. They just had me introduce those people. So.
Oh, okay. I thought these were John Small's businesses.
No. This their own small business. They're like, hey, you're not qualified to talk about how to be successful, but you could introduce the people who are qualified to talk about that.
Now, johnsmall.com, bigjohnsmall.com, right?
Yep, bigjohnsmall.com.
Well, we appreciate you getting up. Well, not getting up because you were up already, but coming on the program. I know it's early there in South Dakota, and I appreciate you being here. It's been great to get to know you. I will check out the John and Heidi show online because obviously I'm not going to pick it up.
It's a lot of fun. They're fun to listen to.
You'll really have to say hello to Greg Warren for me as well. He's a good dude.
I definitely will. Thank you.
Had him on the show twice.
Thank you for coming on, and I appreciate it.
He probably won't remember any of that.
he probably just heard you say that because he just popped in the back, back window now.
Yeah, he's in the back.
Hey, Greg. Hi. Welcome to the show.
Yeah. Anyway, thank you for coming, and do come back sometime. I appreciate it, man.
We'll do that.
Thank you. Bye for now.
See you, John.
Big John Small, folks. BigJohnSmall.com, and it's on KZOI. Sunny Radio. We'll play a brief commercial and we'll be back to meet the aforementioned Greg Warren. Salesman is out now and we'll talk about that when we come back. Right now we're going to talk about naked wines and not the long, boring, ridiculous commercial. No,
has that been retired?
We played it yesterday and basically everybody wanted to come and kill you. So we won't play that again.
We just had to pee.
No, I had to get a cup of coffee and I needed a long spot.
That's the longest commercial break we have. So I was like, I had to pee. He needed coffee. He's like, go.
And then I got back and I was like, man, I can't believe anybody thinks this is funny. It's just.
Are you kidding me? Come on. It's hilarious.
Well, yeah. You are saying your bit is hilarious. It's not exactly. Anyway, Naked Wines. We need some people to get out there and subscribe to wine. It's wine season, isn't it? It's time to get wined up for the holidays. Get all wined up.
That's right,
as they say. Naked Wine.
Welcome to a better way to buy wine. NakedWines.com is a customer-funded wine business. We don't just sell wines, we make them happen. Since launching in the UK in 2008, Angels have helped us invest in over 159 independent winemakers in 14 different countries. Turns out, it's better business for everyone. Our winemakers get to sell all of their wines and make a living. We make the same margins as everyone else and have a lot of fun along the way. And as a wine drinker, for the $40 a month you probably would have spent on wine anyway, you'll get wholesale prices. You can be sure that all of our wines have been lovingly made by a talented winemaker and stripped of all the costs that add nothing to the flavor or quality of the juice in the bottle. Support independent winemakers. Get better wine in return. With the support of 300,000 wine drinkers, we fund talented, stronger winemakers up front. This way, they get to spend all of their attention on making you the best wine possible. World-class wine, direct from talented independent winemakers. A better deal, up to 60% off market prices. A better way to discover tasty new favorites with over 2 million reviews from wine drinkers like you. Become an angel today. Get started by visiting MindDogTV.com and click the banner on the homepage now.
Yes. Click the banner on the homepage now. You know what? I used the maximum de-esser on that, but it still comes through with a lot of sibilance commercial.
You want me to re-record it? I can re-record it, you know.
I think it needs to be redone, and it's not your fault. I rushed you on it, but
it is my fault. I don't think I had my teeth in when I recorded.
I blame John Small because John Small does voiceover work, and then so Willie thought he could do it too.
That's true. I'd like to remind people that this is TD's last day on the program. We wish him well. We hope he does well in his future endeavors, whatever they are. It certainly won't be music or comedy, though, so don't worry about that.
I have other talents I can fail at. I don't just have to fail at.
Well, if you knew anything about music or comedy, you wouldn't be here right now.
I can also fail at making furniture because I'm a very good furniture maker.
All right, quiet down. We're about to introduce our next guest, who's a big shot comedian, funny guy, but he has some St. Louis. If Willie could say St. Louis for us, St. Louis, Missouri, he's got a special out now called The Salesman. It's a very funny special. I implore everybody to go check it out. Welcome, Greg Warren, to Coffee with the Dog. Greg, welcome.
Hey guys, how you doing?
We're doing well. Big John Small says to say hello to you. He's I don't know if you remember him, but he's had you on his program from Sioux Falls, South Dakota.
Wow, that's going back a ways. Yeah.
Let me tell you something that surprises me about you, because I look at you and I think this guy's got it. He's a guy who's got it all together. Now, like, I don't like you. He's coordinated. He's athletic. And then most of your comedy is about beating on yourself and finding out that you are just as screwed up as I am, which is surprising. Your look doesn't go with the self-denigration type of view necessarily.
I think I should say thank you. I mean, that's
yeah. You look like a guy who's got it all together. You don't I look don't, like a man. Guy who your comedy is all about how you don't have it all together.
No, I'm a mess, man.
Yeah. It's surprising. Now you got your start doing football commentary. Is that correct?
No.
Wrestling commentary.
I mean, I wrestled in college, and I did. I think I was the color guy on the one time they broadcast a college wrestling match in Missouri once. Yeah. But it's funny because I think that's like on a bio somewhere and everybody goes to that. So you're a sports commentator. I'm like, I mean, once. Yeah. Once,
I thought I heard Diane Gallagher on the mixtape mashup or whatever her podcast is that describe you as getting your start as a color person for sports on the radio.
Well, I love Diane, but she's a liar if she said that.
The Salesman now, basically, you were 54 when you made that. Are you still 54?
55.
All right. So you made it. Because I had this thing my whole life, like 54 was my curse. I was not going to make it past 54. So when I turned 55, it was like a new lease on life. It was like I did not expect it to make it past 54. Do you feel like you're in the prime of your life and enjoying what you do?
I mean, yeah. I mean, my professional life, definitely. I feel like, I figured some things out in the last 5 years that I didn't know I would figure out. I mean, I'm a lot better at it. I think I enjoy it more.
Yeah.
I wish I would have figured it out when I was, you know, in my mid 30s or something. And
you can't plan that stuff out, but here's the big $66,000 question or whatever the hell I'm trying to say. Because we talk about levels of comedy, and I'm just wondering if the place of gratitude that, because there are, I probably say, no exaggeration, 2 million comedians right now who would kill to be at the level of comedy that you are. Do you ever stop and reflect on that? Like, you've reached and it's probably hard to come to that place where you feel satisfied. And I'm not saying satisfied, but a place of gratitude for so many people would love to occupy the level of comedy that you've reached and how difficult that is.
Well, I don't know about gratitude. I mean, I have a list of all 2 million of those guys, and I send them emails
It only takes one. It only takes one to kill you.
Yeah, I send them all emails saying I'm better than you, and I hope that you know that. And there's an official record. There's a guy saying it on a program that I'm better than all you guys. And I don't know where you got your account, but I had 2.5 million actually of these.
I was just guessing, actually.
Amateur.
I am rated the 1,186,788th funniest person on the planet.
Don't pay any attention to that. Oh, you're
that guy? Really,
that's me. That's me.
Man, I've been waiting to meet you. It's but it's a
pleasure to meet you too.
Yeah, pleasure to meet you. I've heard a lot about you. I mean,
But we were talking this morning about the difference between like amateurs and professionals in comedy. And now you are at the place where because you are doing specials, you kind of have to continually be writing and coming up with new material, right? Or do you feel that
pressure? Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you know what? It's funny because I think I, in some ways, dreaded that process early on. You just like, you know, you're like, oh, I got to get this material done so I can get out and do it. And now it's the only thing that keeps me interested. Right? And most of my friends that are, you know, my age or good comics, that's what keeps you going. Is it's like, okay, it's slightly torturous, but it's like, now I got to start over and I got to build a new hour. And, I have a little more patience maybe than I should. Cause I've heard Seinfeld say like he obsesses about it every hour of the day. I don't. But now I'm like, I think when I was in my 30s, I was like, yeah, let's figure this bit out right now. And whatever it is, that's what's going on stage. I'm like, okay, let's play around with this idea. And more than likely, it's going to take 3, 6, 9, 12 months to turn into something worthwhile. So just put in the time, just enjoy it, and trust that you have skills now that you didn't used to have. I don't know if that makes sense.
Yeah. Is it like music where you get 10 years to write your first hit album, and then every album after that, you get 6 months?
I think that's interesting you said that. But it's not quite that timing. I think your first album, you can spend as much time as you want on because nobody knows who you are. And then I think it does take a while. I kind of just put it out when it's ready. I think the last thing, The Salesman, took me about 3 years, and I recorded that a year ago. So I'm a year in and I'm like, man, I think I could do this next one. And, 2 years or 2.5 years. Right. It's starting to get there. It's not there, so you never know. But ask me this time next year, and I'll tell you like, okay, I'm ready, or I screwed around for the last.
That's interesting. Before we go any further, I want to say you're at the Funny Bone in Columbus, Ohio this week. This is an Ohio week. Everybody has some connection. Well, Big John didn't have a connection to Ohio, but almost every other guest does. Ohio, Central Ohio, right in the middle of, well, I think right in the middle of the country, but they really are Eastern time zone. Do you alter your show for where you're going in the throughout the country?
Not really. I think sometimes in New York City, it's a little different. I lived in the city for 5 years. So I think in the heart of New York City, I slightly alter my show. And if you're doing shows like in Hollywood, I think there's a style that maybe you need to observe. Other than that, I kind of try to do the same shows. I mean, there's little regional things. I lived in Ohio for 5 years, so I know a little bit about it. The Salesman was about selling peanut butter, and I sold peanut butter in Ohio.
About consuming peanut butter.
What's that?
I thought it was about only consuming peanut butter. Though, right? Being the... I'm the eater, you the maker.
Yeah. As a trusted Jif salesman, yes, I consume my product. I'm not, some shill. Just
let me do this. But the air, because I was going to ask you, most of the dates that you have now, except there's one in New Jersey, most of them are. Oh, and there's a Miami too. I didn't see, like middle of the country, like that. That's that lane of Midwestern type of people. Is that your comfort zone?
No, I mean, I'll go anywhere. I think I've always worked a lot of the Midwest, but I go pretty much everywhere.
Yeah. I have a quick question. Do you have a bit about, do you play the flute or did you when you were younger?
I played the clarinet and I had a bit about it. I wrestled and I played the clarinet, and there was this guy on the wrestling team that just would, you know, never let it go. Look at Greg, man. Greg played a flute. I'm like, no, it's a clarinet.
It's a flute, bro. Greg. I opened for you 20 years ago at Nitwits in Sioux Falls.
Oh yeah, man. Yeah.
Oh my God, it was driving me nuts. I'm like, I know, and the only thing I could hear in my head, and by the way, whenever somebody says flute for 20 fucking years, I hear flute your flute, Ray.
Yeah, that's flute. Yeah, yeah.
Thank you for that tidbit that's been haunting me for 20 years.
Man, that Nitwits, the owners, Pat and Michelle, they were great. And if you guys don't mind, I'll tell a quick story about Nitwits.
Please do.
I brought my friend Dave Lease. He was a comic from L.A. I was living in L.A. at the time. And Dave was a younger guy, and he hadn't worked the road much. He was a funny dude, but I was like, dude, come on the road with me. So we go to Nitwits in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. And after the first night, I think it was like a Thursday or Wednesday night, we're just kind of hanging out in the back of the room. And there's this, like, they have like a court jester costume back there that just sitting back there. He's like, what's that for? And I'm just like, I just run with it. I go, what are you talking about, man? He goes, what's that for? I go, dude, that's what the feature act has to put that on and go to the mall and scare up business for the show. He's like, what are you talking about? I'm like, don't act like you don't know. He's like, no, dude, I haven't done the road before. I'm like, on Saturdays, the feature act goes to the mall and does a tight 25-minute set at the mall. And you got to do it at this club. You got to do it in the court jester outfit. He's like, no way. He goes, are you going to be there? I'm like, no, I'm not going to be there, man. I'm the headliner. I don't have to do that. Yeah, and then he goes, he gets real serious. He goes, dude, do I got to be clean? I'm like, it's the mall, man. Yes, you got to be clean. You can't be doing dirty jokes at the mall. Oh, man. I let him go for like 10 minutes on that thing. He thought he had to put on the jester costume and go to the mall.
I love that you did that. I wish I had the power to make people do that. That would definitely make
I'm a little disappointed that you stopped him before he got to put it on.
I know, man. You're right. We should have got him all the way to the mall on that thing, man.
Yeah. And got it caught on and got it recorded on VHS.
Yeah,
I was gonna say, were there cell phones in the day? They probably weren't, right? So that we couldn't tape that and put it on.
I think 20 years ago. Yeah, I think there were cell phones.
Yeah, there were cell phones, man. Flip phones. I'm not 80. I'm 55. There were cell phones.
Flip phones, but not like iPhones.
There probably weren't iPhones. Yeah.
They weren't shooting video a lot on them. I mean, I
four the seconds. Was like you got 4 seconds of video.
Yeah.
With the memory they had, you got 4 seconds of video.
Let me assure you, if I would have got leased to the mall in the jester costume, we would have found a video camera somewhere.
Yeah, somebody with a big camera would have come in.
Yeah, there's it's the mall, man. They were selling those giant JVCs. Yeah.
The local news station would have come out to cover it.
Did you have to do a lot of like indentured servant, like barkers and working the door at places coming up and all that kind of stuff that they make?
No, I mean, I was a little fortunate. I mean, I didn't do the barking thing because I think that's if you start in New York City is basically what that is. Yeah. Right. And I didn't start in New York City. By the time I got to New York City, you know, I was already somewhat established. I did some, you know, bringers, a couple in LA where it's, you know, it's stupid. And, you know, you bring your 10 friends and you get to go on stage and it's fine, except for like you're making 10 friends sit through some of the worst comedy that they've ever, you know, it's like, I did it twice. I'm like, I'm never going to make my friends ever sit through like 2.5 hours of horrible comedians. And then I was a little fortunate in that I worked for 10 years. I was selling peanut butter for 10 years and I made good money and I had some money saved up, and I didn't have to take all the bad gigs. I didn't have to. It's not as romantic, but I didn't have to sleep in my car. If we got to the hotel and it was horrible, I'd be like, well, I'm going to get my own hotel. Like, you know, cause I had a little bit of money.
Yeah. How did you get into that? I mean, was there ad in the paper help wanted sales, but I mean, how do you get into peanut butter sales?
Are you kidding me, man? This is
you don't grow up thinking I want to sell
peanut butter. Calling, man. It's a calling. I had a purpose,
Did you ever feel like you spread yourself a little thin?
How long you been sitting on that one?
No, but you have to wonder. I mean, how some of these careers come up. Now, have you ever been married? You're not married now,
no,
right?
No,
you've never been married.
Never married.
Is that by? I mean, was that a choice you made early in life? Like, I'm just comedy is not conducive to having
a, I think it might have been the load life. Maybe it's like the sum of 100 selfish choices, or maybe somewhat,
yeah,
short,
yeah, no,
somewhat
I get
short,
it.
Short-sighted choices. Maybe, you know, I dated a few people, and I got into it late. So I was early 30s on the road, and I had to kind of restart a career, and you're on the road, and you know, I did have fun. I met some girls on the road, and you know, there's a couple that I probably should have like kept dating or pursued a little bit more, but you're like, man, I'm going to be in this next town tomorrow. And, I got this show coming up and all that. And I think, you know, I'm not sad or anything like that, but I do wonder if at some point, yeah.
Well, I talk to my brother all the time, and
I'm sad to an educated eye. It's extremely sad, but I'm too dumb to see it, is what I'm trying to say.
I think because my brother's a bachelor, and when I talk to, he's always talking about women. I'm like, dude, do you not see? Take a look at my life. You don't want my life. You don't want anything. But you said selfish. I think more selfless, knowing that, you know what, I'm going to be on the road. There's no, you know what, you can't build a life around me. I'm going to do what I want to do. And that was my plan. I just don't know how I fell off it. We always had a plan, no chicks in the band, too, but we ended up hiring chicks in the band.
Oh, yeah?
Yes, you know, it's always that thing where the plan was to say, you know, this is not a life for a wife to be attached to.
Look, yeah. I understand. I never wanted to be a black comedian. I always wanted to be an Asian comedian.
Yeah.
And those are not the cards I was dealt, you know?
Right. I always wanted to see you as an Asian comedian, too. you gotta stick with what you got, but I think you would have been great as an Asian comedian. I really do.
I think I would have also, but I won't know now.
You would have been great as an uppity Jamaican. You mentioned before the guy, Dave Reese, I think you said his name was.
Oh, Lease. Yeah, Lease. Yeah.
So he said, do I have to work clean? Now, that suggests that he was not necessarily a comedian who works clean, but you do. Are you cognizant of having features and openers who work clean, or it doesn't matter?
Man, now I am. I think for a while I was kind of like, I'll follow whoever. You know, I don't want to tell guys what to do. Here's the thing, man. I have gotten, I'm not an international superstar, but I some people come to the shows now, and they come because they want to see me, and they've seen me on wherever, they've watched a couple of specials. They see me on TV, or they see me on something like this. And, or they hear me on Sirius Radio, which was, I'll tell you later, like that's kind of was the impetus of why I went totally clean. But I feel like they come to a show now and they sort of expect to see a somewhat clean show. And if the guy in front of me is overly filthy, they're not going to get up and leave. But I feel like it's not exactly fair to them, because I can see they're kind of like, you know, they're not the kind of people like, I'm, this is an outrage. They're just kind of like, I didn't really, this isn't what I expected. Yeah. So now, and I'm pretty much G. If you go to a show, I mean, every now and then on a late show, if there's an interaction with the crowd, you'll hear, you know, you'll hear a little profanity, but not very often. But the guys in front of me, I would rather they be clean, but I'm not as rigid with them as I am with myself. Like, gotcha. You know,
I'm surprised to hear you say that, because on the dry bar comedy special you did about 5 years ago, I think, there was something that it wasn't profane. There was no profanity in it, but right. I thought, wow, this is not for the Mormon crowd. And I thought it was a little bit suggestive of, I don't know, sexual stuff, or I forget what it was, even the bit. But I remember questioning it, like, how you got away with that? Because they are squeaky clean out there.
Yeah, and, yeah. I wonder what I bet I would know what it was. I think I could guess. And I probably regret doing it in that set, you know.
It seemed to get a good laugh, though. But that was what I was questioning.
Well, then I don't regret doing it. Anything.
Yeah, no. I get it. That was the thing that I was thinking. Like, I would not have had the balls to try to even try that on that crowd, because I've seen my friends go out there and really have a tough time with the line, where you draw that line, and it right. seemed to work for you. And it's like, well, he knew that would work. I don't know how.
I know the line for the, you know, from I've done a number of corporate gigs. I worked for a corporation. I know, man, I was never like filthy ever. I was way more profane than I am now. 10 years ago, 15 years ago. And there's a guy that runs Sirius XM comedy, a guy named Jack Vaughn, who, man, if there's industry that's been in my corner, Jack is the number one guy. Like, he used to be a Comedy Central Records. He did my first album. And I don't know, I think when he started at Sirius, he wanted to revamp the Clean channel a little bit. They have a channel that's, you know, kids can listen to. And he was like, hey man, you're way too clean to not be all the way clean. What are you doing? Knock it off. Like, just go all the way on this. It's a right. little bit of discipline, and you're taking out, you know, you're going to lose three bits. And he goes, if you do, there's a lot of places that you can get played that you don't get played now. And I really took it right. to heart, and it just kind of started working out for me. 'Cause I was always on that edge anyways. You know, I was, right. I think I was just lazy or afraid, to go all the way clean.
So. Interesting. Yeah. Do you think that's great advice to either to make a decision? Because I know clean or comedians who don't necessarily work clean but can work clean if it's called for. Do you think you have to draw a line and either work clean or not?
No, I think it's whatever works for you. I think that you need to be true to yourself to some degree. I mean, I think whatever you like. I love when people come up to me after the show and they're like, well, we're so appreciative that you're clean. And I'm like, thank you. You know, and they're like, it's a higher form of comedy. I'm like, I don't think that, it's like, they're like, it's easy to be dirty. I'm like, is it really? You do it and see how well you do, you know, like, right. Go up there and go watch any one of Dave Attell's sets and tell me how easy that is. 'Cause it's not,
right.
There's nobody that thinks at that level, you know? So like, I think there's plenty of comics, you know, it's something for everyone. I just think like if you are always thinking about dirty jokes and that's what makes you laugh and that's what made your friends and your family laugh, like probably go in that lane. That's who you are. I just, I think you can't be exactly who you want to be all the time, because there's such a thing as the media, and there, you know, you have to fit into certain medium. Into a certain medium. So it's like, you know, if I really was myself, I would probably be as clean as I am with a little, especially when I do a character, a little profanity, salt and peppered in. But I've learned if I do that, it's just going to, exclude all these people offends. Yeah, you might as well not do that. And you get more people to watch you. And I do shows now, like, one of the funner shows we do, I'm doing it in Columbus. I only do it in 5 markets. Is on it. We do a matinee show, and it's kids can come. And, you know, I'm pretty much just doing my act. And then at the end of the show, we bring the kids on stage and interview them and let them tell jokes and stuff. And yeah, like I would have never been able to do that stuff had I not, had I not just made the move. And I have Jack to thank for it.
Well, I know you didn't ask me to come on and promote this, but I want to promote the December 8th through 10th. Now, that's Friday, Saturday, and Sunday you're doing it at the Funny Bone.
Yeah.
Three shows in a row. Now, are you doing two shows either Friday or Saturday?
I think two Friday, two Saturday, and then Sunday is the matinee kids show and then an evening, early
five,
evening show.
Wow, five shows in a weekend. That's a lot.
Yeah. Well, yeah. See, that's the back in the day. So, like Nitwits, back in the day, they ran a Wednesday, a Thursday, two on Friday, two on Saturday. And in my opinion, like I think that's a really good setup for comics to come into town, do the week, and then go. You know what I mean? Rather than these one night, you know what I mean? Because you don't know what people's schedules are. You know what I mean? It's so hard to make sure you're available for one night. So if you go to a city and you're doing, you know, five shows throughout the week, I think that's, or six shows, I always think that's a better setup, for sure. Right.
Now, how long has it been that people in the audience are there to see you? Because for every comic, you start out, you're just a person that's in front of a crowd that is not necessarily there to see you. But now, and I don't know how long it's been when you realize that the room is full of people who are there to see you. And that makes a big difference. They know the comedy you do. They know what to expect. And they're more likely to enjoy the evening. When did you cross that line from being in front of audiences you were just another comic on the bill to being the guy they came to see?
Well, I mean, it's always a mix. It's certainly not 100% of the people there know who I am at every show, but it's the mix is in my favor. Now I think probably 2004, I went on the Bob and Tom show for the first time, a radio show that's syndicated all over, especially in the Midwest. And I did, I did that Flute Man bit and I did some other stuff and it got really, I got popular on that show pretty quickly. And so at that point, real quick, I realized, there were people there to see me. So since then, it's like ebbed and flowed of, this last year has been probably the best. But it's ebbed and flowed. And like, you get in some places and nobody knows who you are. And then you get in some places and it's like everybody knows who you are. So it's, And I think it's funny. I think it's healthy to do it in front of people that don't know who you are. It keeps you a little bit humble. And I think it does sort of force you into like, is this joke really funny? Like when I'm preparing for a special, I do some corporate gigs and they're harder. They just are. It's in day. It's the setting isn't right. It's the lighting's bad. The sound's bad. You're in a, sort of, hotel conference room or whatever it's harder. So usually, and I can usually do pretty well in those because I'm just doing the best of. I'm doing the best bits I've written over the last 20 years and editing it out all the stuff that has nuance to it or subtlety. But when I get a special where I think it's right there, I'll okay, I'm gonna do a couple chunks from the special in a corporate. And if it works there, now I know I got something. So that the salesman, right. I had this peanut butter chunk of 15 minutes. And I started doing it at corporates. And not only was it doing well, it was the best thing of any material I did that night. And I was like, I think I might have something with this new special. It's killing in corporates,
Yeah.
And that's gotta be one of the best feelings, right?
It's a great feeling, man.
Yeah, corporate is so weird because people almost feel like they're forced to be there. It's a day that they were supposed to be off. Now we got to go into work, sit on uncomfortable chairs in a ballroom, and do something we mandated to do. And so if you can kill in that room, it's going to work for anybody who was out intentionally looking to laugh. So
yeah. You said that's a great feeling. It is a great feeling. I think the best feeling is when you have a bit that's just starting to turn the corner. It's like you got this bit and you thought there was something there And then it just starts to get like big laughs. And you know, it's not done. You know, it's like, man, I got 2 months left to find the right words on this bit, but I'm on to something here. Man, I don't know if there's a more fun feeling in entertainment than that. Cause you're right.
It really gets you excited.
Yeah.
The only thing I can think of that's better than that saying goodbye to Govs. That's the only thing I can think of that's better than what you just
saying goodbye to what?
Saying goodbye to Govs.
I have to say goodbye to Governor's Comedy Network.
Oh, Governor's Comedy Club?
One of the networks we were on this morning. By the way, Tom Green Thursday night. This Thursday night, the Tom Green,
I've played Governor's, I think, or the one that they own that's not called Governor's.
McGuire's or Brokerage.
I played the Brokerage one time. It was great, man.
Yeah, Brokerage is a great club.
My dad's from Long Island, so it was cool to do that.
Yeah, and best sound system of any comedy club, which is really important to a guy like me. So Tom Green Thursday night, go check him out. We're saying bye to Govs right now. Bye, Govs. We'll see you tomorrow. Thanks for being here. Now, a lot of your comedy is the base. What really brings it home is the delivery and your strategic or pauses and the way your delivery and basically timing and all that kind of stuff. When the pandemic hit, and because The Salesman, I'm thinking, was developed during a layoff where you could not practice that stuff. Did that make you question whether, when the first time going back out after lockdown and trying to deliver that material, were you certain about it, or were there questions in your mind? Because the timing, you can't practice that without a crowd, right? You can't do that in your
own. Yeah. That's really interesting you say that. I mean, a lot of it was developed during the pandemic. I think you get to a certain point where you're like, I'm reasonably certain I've got something here. Now, I don't know how long it's going to take me to stop stuttering around the words or find the right words or pause in the right places, but I'm starting to trust more and more that I will figure that out if I've got an idea, you know. And I think it's there's really a few barriers. The first thing is, what do you want to say? Like, can you crystallize what you want to say? And that's harder than you think, because it's like, there's something in there and there's something around this idea, but I don't even know I don't really know what I'm trying to say. So and sometimes that takes a while to figure it out. Sometimes on stage, you just go up and be like, there's this thing around poison ivy that I want to talk about. And you just talk and then you find it. So that's one level. The next is like, you know what you want to say, but you're not using the right words for them to see what you're trying to say. And that, you know, that's another level. And then I think it's just, can you get it out in a consistent manner? You know, can you breathe the right way? You know, can you not sound like, I'm trying to get this out. You know, I'm desperate to say this. So over time I've kind of, the goal is that I think I got something moment. I'll usually figure out how to say it. And I have the patience where if it's good, there's a couple things in the stand where it took 2 years to really figure out how to say it the right way.
No smoke intended here. I don't do false flattery, but I don't think anybody working today uses a strategic pause as good as you do. I think
buddy.
Really, really impressive. And I'm over analytical to comedy, but when I look at people, I don't see anybody doing that. That's an art form unto itself. I mean, there's all sorts of little tricks and stuff within the craft, but that one I think is one that got overlooked. You use it like a master. So,
You know, I was thinking about, and that sort of happened default. Like, and I have to admit to myself, I think that there is some influence there. You know, like I think Jake Johansson. I hope I'm not emulating him too much, because, you know, like I think I learned a little bit about that working with Jake. I think Woody Allen did it in an interesting way. And I'm a big Newhart fan, And I think, I think so. All those guys together, and Hedberg, all those guys together, I'm like, I hope I'm not emulating them too much. But I would have to admit to myself that, cause I don't remember thinking like, you got to start pausing. It's just like, you start talking in a different way and you do like, I want them to listen to this idea because this is the thing that you need to hear. So sometimes rather than say it louder, shut up for a second and then say it, and maybe they'll hear it more clearly at that, absolutely, at that point.
Well, yeah. The pause intensifies what you're, you know what I mean? Like, it builds the emotion.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and again, you know, it, masterful work. Masterful,
I just paused work there before I said yes. I don't know if you guys.
Now, corporate work, that's an interesting stuff. You do keynote speeches and stuff like that, which is not necessarily corporate comedy.
Yeah.
That's a whole different game, right?
Yeah, most of the time it's just we need somebody to be funny for an hour, you know, and be clean. Every now and then they'll be like, hey, in order to pay you, we need to have some sort of takeaway. And I have like one sort of keynote about using humor to overcome failure. But what it is, it took me a while to like live with myself to like, I don't want this to be something that I don't believe in, you know?
Right. Yeah,
so it was funny. Like, so it's basically like an hour of stand-up comedy with about 3 minutes of, hey, there might be something to take away from this. You know, yeah. And I was in corporate America. I went to those meetings. And you're not going to take away, you're not going to get adults to listen and take away 9 things. If you can get them to take away 1 thing, you know, you're doing well. So I tell people, like, if they're like, we need a keynote speaker. And I'm like, hey, guys, if you want a motivational speaker, if you want somebody that's, you know, a good amount of serious, don't hire me. Like, I'm not that guy. I want to make them laugh for an hour and then say, hey, here's 1 thing. Maybe, you know, I'm just like, hey, if you notice, most of what I talked about was my own failings.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. That's what I said. You know. That's the thing that doesn't, it's really incongruent to me. Cause you look, your appearance is like a guy who doesn't have all those failings. And that's, you know, as a guy who was a very failed person, I look at you and like, my first instinct is, oh, this guy's better than me. He's got to together. And then you start talking and I was like, he's just like me.
I could if you don't believe me, I could have some of my ex-girlfriends, friends, people, they can write you some letters detailing some of my failures
but I had a friend who he was doing a keynote thing, and it was for a big corporation I'm not going to name here, but everybody, a brand that everybody knows, and they asked him to roast some of the corporate heads, and he did his research, and he went too far and got thrown out.
Yes, yes. they always say that stuff, or then like some idiot will come, so be like, "Hey, man, you can say whatever you want. Don't worry about like just say whatever." I'm like, "Yeah, man. I don't see vice president on your name tag or whatever. I'm not gonna just because." Whatever the lowest guy in the organization told me he wanted to hear me swear at the corporate event, I'm not going to do it. They're paying me a bunch for this.
Like, yeah, great gigs.
And they don't know what they want sometimes, because they will tell you roast the guy or whatever. Like, I mean, I will if it comes up.
Right.
If something comes up organically, I think, man, I was doing this. It was like a heating and cooling company, a big company last year. And I just happened to sort of listen to their awards or something. They were talking about one of the other public speakers they had. And it was the number one sales guy in the company that was just killing it. And they were like talking about him like he was a god, you know? And he was down in Phoenix, and I was like, I'm gonna take a risk here. I did, you know, not right off the bat. Like, you get him on your side, and then I go, hey, by the way, man, you guys are making this guy out to be some huge like god. Correct me if I'm wrong. you're an air conditioning company and he lives in Phoenix. Like, it's not that big a deal, guys. Like,
yeah, it's not selling that, snowballs to Eskimo. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, guys, right.
It's not such a big, and then it worked, man. And if you do one of those, you kind of go off script and roast them just a little bit, you're gold, man. Then you're in good shape. Yeah.
Wow. I appreciate you getting up and coming on the program. I'm a big fan, and hopefully
I really enjoyed talking to you guys, man. Yeah, this is a lot of fun.
This weekend at the Funny Bone in Columbus, Ohio, December 8th, two shows, December 9th, two shows, and then a Sunday show, a matinee show at the Funny Bone in Columbus, Ohio. Go see Greg Warren. You'll laugh your testicles off because we are working clean here.
Oh, that won't take me half as long.
Greg, it's been a pleasure. Thanks. And please do come back sometime. I mean,
absolutely, man. Thanks, guys. Really enjoyed talking to you.
Have a great day. Yeah. Bye for now.
All right. We'll see you.
Bye. Greg Warren, gregwarrencomedy.com, folks. We have to say goodbye to PBMTV really fast. PBMTV, fill out especially musicians. We want to get more musicians on here. Fill out the form and come on the program. Let's get you some exposure for your music over there on PBMTV. Bye for now, PBMTV. We'll see you tomorrow morning. And I believe on Sunday, the Rev was going to be, I think it was on last weekend. I think there were more people watching church on PBMTV than any other place. So, We appreciate that. you got to get a correspondence to the Rev for me, because I know there's issues with why he does it on Sunday morning. Of course, church is Sunday morning, but there are people who do church at different times, like Saturday night, Saturday evening, Sunday evening, something like that. Because this week the church, the Rev mentioned that he hasn't lost any subscribers on his YouTube channel, but we have lost half a dozen or more from my channel because people on Sunday morning like to sleep in. And if they ring the bell to know when there's fresh content on, when the Rev starts doing his show, that bell rings at 9 a.m. on Sunday morning. And this Sunday, we ended up losing 18 subscribers. We got back a bunch of them. Maybe if we could figure out something other than Sunday morning, that would be a good idea. Like later in the day, or Saturday afternoon, something. But 9 o'clock in the morning, you're laying in bed. That's one day to lay in. You don't want your phone waking, saying, go watch Mind Dog TV. You know what I'm saying?
So, 11?
I don't know. You talk to the Rev and just express that and see what you come up with. That's all I'm saying.
I'll have him talk
to or him. Or you just have it on his channel, on Dr. Rev Jelly Roll's YouTube channel, and not on mine. So the people who rang the bell for this or notified when there's stuff like this or shorts on don't get a buzz on Sunday morning that says wake up and I know this is your day to sleep in, but we want you to get up and watch something you didn't sign up for. This is the problem I'm dealing with the whole YouTube stuff anyway, is trying to separate the channels so that people, if they signed up for one thing, are not getting the bell ringing at other times.
I see.
That's what we're trying to deal with anyway. Okay. Two good guests today. Yes, you enjoyed both.
That was a trip. Because you were talking about him being on the show, coming up on the show, I was like, I know this sounds really familiar. And as soon as he came on and I started hearing him talk, I'm like, I definitely.
How do you feel that guy? How do you feel that you remembered him very well, but he didn't remember you at all?
I mean, I was a host. I was the host. At a show he did.
I remember everybody I ever met.
That's not true. That's definitely not true.
I remember everybody I ever met.
Unless they changed genders.
If they were a kid.
Didn't remember Chris, did you?
I still don't. I'm still doubting that whole thing. You know what? I don't know about that. Anyway.
Yeah.
But no, so, but if you were a host of a show that I was on, I think I'd remember you. I think I would.
Yeah, but whatever.
Whatever.
I mean, it doesn't hurt my heart at all.
I want it to hurt your heart. I want to hurt your feelings. This is why I'm bringing it up. I want you to cry. Cry. Well, cry. Thanks. Damn it, cry.
Hey. All right, that's fine.
I feel a little better. My spirits are lifted up. Thank you. Thank you for
okay,
that.
Okay, you're welcome. I'm glad I could help.
Last night, Barry Katz had a writer's workshop on Blueprint for Success. People should sign up for that. There's a free link.
Yeah, no, I'm going to go back and watch that video today for sure, because I got the notification, but I'm super busy last night, but I definitely...
It was a breakdown of Kim Wadsworth's set.
Oh, great.
He had taped for her. Now, they had like a show somewhere, a military show where that she was on, and he taped it. And it was breaking it down and stopping it along the way to comment on it. But, a lot of gold in there in what he was talking about and bringing out points of why her stuff works so well and the important parts of it. And I think anybody who doesn't take part in that, because it is absolutely free, you don't have to pay anything for this. And I don't think you're going to get better analysis or comedy advice or career advice for free anywhere. And I'm not just saying that because we're an affiliate. If you want, we have an affiliate link on mindogtv.com. If you go in the blog section, there's in the right hand side there, there's a link to Blueprint for Success. If you sign up through there, we get credit for it. I'm not saying it just for that. Believe me, if it wasn't great, I would not tell you it was great. For me, riveting stuff, really important stuff, and I'm becoming a bigger fan of Kim's work. Let's face it.
Yeah, Kim is great.
Yeah, I know she's great. But there, for me, how do I put this without being like derogatory? For me, as a straight white male from New York, I'm not going to be her target audience, and I'm right. Not necessarily relatable right off the bat to a guy like me, because she's a lesbian from Texas, military. And, I got to get used to the Texas accent and all that stuff. Just, takes a lot. But I'm becoming a big fan.
But that's a real marker of the quality of her work, too, is that she could be entertaining even to an audience that's not her target audience.
Right, right.
And that really says something.
Yeah, but it definitely helps when he points out why things, he broke, the analysis was so good that I definitely look forward to going back. And I know I'm pitching this pretty hard, but anybody who's into comedy out there, sign up for the Blueprint for Success. You don't have to buy the premium or diamond level stuff just to be on those calls. And again, that's worth its weight in gold. So do it.
Yeah, I agree.
What are you doing? You got anything coming up this week? What are you doing? You're taking a bus ride back to Grant's to go get your stuff and then...
No, actually, I think my friend Dakota was actually talking about wanting to come out here.
Wait, you got a friend Dakota who lives in Dakota?
No, he lives in New Mexico. I have a friend named Dakota that lives in New Mexico.
But do you have a friend named New Mexico who lives in Dakota?
Yeah. No.
All right, I'm sorry. I interrupted you. Go ahead.
No,
it's okay. I'll watch Twitter.
But this week, I'm actually... So it's not a comedy show that I'm partaking in. And this is actually another thing that John Small got me hooked up with. You remember during the summer, I did the mocktail mix-off and I won the People's Choice Award for the drink that I made, Mountain View. Yeah. So they're doing a holiday mocktail mix-off on the 7th, and I will be participating in that. I'm going to be presenting the drink that I'm making called Holiday Warmth. And so I really look forward to that. That's another chance for me to win some stuff. I'm really doing a lot of different kind of stuff. I mean, of course I'll do a couple mics while I'm in town and stuff, but
so
the mocktail mix-off is the
Are you going back to New Mexico on the 13th still? Is that still part of the plan?
I don't think so, which is why I want to have Dakota or somebody bring that to me. If you don't want me to mail it, I understand that, but I think I can get Dakota.
Yeah, I don't really, because it's delicate equipment, first of all. This time of year, there's lots of thefts going on in.
Oh, yeah, that's definitely true. I didn't even think about that. I didn't even think about, like, porch snatchers and shit like that. Yeah. I do know that it did arrive, and it is secure. My sister has it. I have my sister grab it.
Well, we'll look forward to, first of all, your pot. Now, it's been good the last couple of times you've been on, but you can't, that's in South Dakota, not New Mexico.
Right.
We look forward to you having a better connectivity and better all of that on the pod, but also it's a recording studio, so you know, you can actually
work. Yeah, no, I'm gonna go hard in the paint, bro. I'm gonna get busy.
You got to get your kid to help you figure out the tech stuff of it. I don't know how good you are with setting that stuff up and understanding recording studio software. Part of it has a little soundboard that has effects and all that kind of stuff. And sound, you know, for podcasting and for recording stuff. So we look forward to actually hearing you produce some new music with that stuff.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah. And good luck with this winning $1,000. $1,000 is a big win if you win that, right? That does that's a big smile on your face.
Can't remember the last time I had like four digits in an account or my pocket.
Well, because my wife has been watching Deal or No Deal, and like somebody who wins $1,000 is depressed. You know what I mean? Right. Like, it's all a matter of reference and a frame of reference and where you are in life. Because if you win $1,000, it's gonna make your week or month or make you happy.
Oh yeah, for real. I mean, that would definitely cover my travel expenses to Florida at the end of January.
You going to Florida at the end of January? Is this
dude? I'm going to the Rumble, bro. I mean, that's why I want the whole. That's why I wanted to get the press thing so that I could do the press affiliate for the Rumble.
So
it's my birthday that day too. I don't know if you know that.
January,
the Royal Rumble is happening on my birthday.
Wow! I don't know. I could have sworn you were born in the spring. I thought you and Dave like had a birthday together.
January 27th.
All right. So, which is the day my grandfather died. Thank you for reminding me of that.
Hey, it's the day my dad died. So I mean, what do you?
Is Maryland on the way from South Dakota to Florida? It is, right?
Depends on how you drive.
Maryland is north.
Wondering if maybe you could go stop by GD's place and like have a fist fight out on his lawn or something and tape it for the show.
Well, the thing is, my yard, like,
you got an excuse you can't make the fight.
It's an explanation.
And you know what? I did just find out I have a show in Mitchell on the 12th, the Mac Daddy of a Mall show, which is a celebration of life for Mackenzie Dagan, who passed away 15 years ago. But we're doing like a huge party. Dude, I got involved with this event. David Dagan is a guy that I actually did some time with. And he called me and told me about this event and asked me if I wanted to co-host it with him and do some comedy. We have Jerry Irby is actually going to be on the show also. But there's a parade leading to the venue. And like it's going to be huge. The local paper's doing a story on it. We're advertising on four different radio stations about the event. And I heard last night that I might be getting put through a table. So that'll be fun. So,
put through a table?
Yeah. You know, because there's a lot of wrestling fans in the Midwest. I don't know if you know that. It sounds like I might get put through a table, which sounds like loads of good fun.
So it sounds to me like GD is always, he's never going to fight you because he's like, he's ducking you. It sounds like that's what
I understand it. It's an understandable thing to do. You know?
He's afraid of getting his ass kicked. That's all. That's all.
Well, anyway. And like I'm really difficult to beat because I never stop getting back up.
Oh, wow. All right. Tough guy, eh? You're a tough guy? You think you're a tough
I mean,
guy?
Yeah, you know, you got to be tough when you get beat up by a silverback gorilla your entire childhood. You know what I mean? Like, it creates some resiliency within you.
All right. Well, tomorrow we switch gears and we have the very dirty Arielle Julie on. Are you going to be on the program tomorrow?
Yes, I'm very excited for her to be on. We've been Facebook friends for a hot minute, so
she's really filthy dirty, and this is what I'm looking forward to, filthy dirty, because we had two clean guys on today, and there were a few.
We got to dirty it up. We got to get some dirt on our knees. That's for sure.
So I look forward to that. It's going to be a good show. Anyway, that's the show for today. I hope this was kind of a back to good shows again, rather than those no shows that we've been having lately. So I'm happy with it. All right.
Did Genie freeze? Are you okay over there, man?
He's been really. I think he's hurt. I think he's hurt because I told him this was his last day on the program. But we don't really need him anyway.
Oh my God, Jesus! I'm
kidding. I'm kidding. We love GD. We love GD. We just want to see Willie beat the fuck out of him on his lawn. But that's not going to happen because GD will go out that day. He'll run away from his own home if he knows that you're coming through town. This is the kind of pussy he is. I would not be afraid to fight Willie. If Willie came here and wanted to fight, I would definitely meet him out on the front lawn.
Just so you know, I don't ever want to fight.
Yes, you do. You want to fight GD on the front lawn. I don't want to fight. Yes,
ever.
You do. You do, too.
No.
You do.
No, I'd much rather be a man of peace. Yeah. But if fighting is required, you do. I will.
You do.
Sure.
You do.
I do.
You do.
I mean, I do fight in a lot of different ways, just not, physically.
You want to fight him physically. You do.
Oh, my God.
You do.
Yeah.
All right. I'm going to kick you guys both out, and then you'll probably try to sneak back in, but I'll just put the whammy and the kazoo on you and then get out of here really fast and say.
Yeah, see, I wish I knew how to even do any of that. I don't know how to bring.
Well, when you get your setup from Dakota in Sioux Falls, New Mexico. when you get your new setup, you will be able to do that. And that you probably, I don't know. Maybe it's the phone. Maybe it's the old fashioned way that you come in. I don't know, but you have access now to be able to do that. Yeah. Anyway, so I hope you get your new stuff soon. That would be good.
Yeah, I'll coordinate with people today and see what we can make happen for.
All right, and beat the shit out of GD for me. Okay, bye now. Bye for both of you guys. Wait, get out. Everybody get out. That's the show for today. I'm telling you to go. I hope you go to bigjohnsmall.com and Greg Warren Comedy and check out our two guests today. Great stuff today. Two great, great guests. I hope you enjoyed the show. Now go turn on your radio. And don't forget.
to me, listen to me, listen to me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now.